I want all of you to reflect what you have learned in the previous lecture and try to summarize. So the way we're going to do this by in pairs, you know, you discuss with your friend sitting next to you, and I'll give you about 3 minutes or 4 minutes and try to summarize what you have learned in the previous lecture, important points that you have learned. And after that, I will invite one or two of you to come in front here to explain to the class. Okay? So this is a good way to summarize the gist of what we have learned. In very briefly, okay? So discuss with your friend next to you. Try to explain what you have understood to your friend, and after that, switch. Okay? 3 minutes. 3 minutes. Not more than 3 minutes. I would like to invite maybe 2 persons here. Maybe one is Shuhaira. Shuhaira, right? Shuhaira. More or less the same. Shuhaira, and maybe who else? Mongling. Mongling. Okay. Shuhaira first. Can you come forward? Very briefly, just the gist, inti pati, the essence.
From our previous lesson, starch in the native form, we can find it in tuber such as cassava. Cassava is a root, tuber, and then from rice and also corn. The starch contain amylose and amylopectin. Okay, amylose contain alpha 1,4 glycosidic bond, and amylopectin contain 1,4 glycosidic bond with branch 1,6 glycosidic bond. Okay. The important point here is that amylose can form strong gel, whereas amylopectin does not form jelly properties. Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay, and then molecular weight, amylose has a lower molecular weight compared to amylopectin. Under the polarized light, the gelatinization of starch showing the prepingence.
Not the gelatinization. When we look the starch, native starch granule under the microscope, under the polarized microscope, so you can see the Maltese cross. It is due to the birefringence effect. What in the starch granule give that effect, the Maltese cross? What component in the starch granule give that effect?
Amylopectin,
because the amylopectin form the crystalline
structure.
So therefore, starch is a semi crystalline. So you can see that under the polarized microscope. What happens if we cook the starch? Would we still see the Maltese cross?
No. Because
so we can use that as an indication of
whether the starch is fully cooked
or not, right? And we can monitor the process of gelatinization by looking at the changes in the Maltese cross. If the Maltese cross disappears completely, meaning that the starch has been fully cooked or fully gelatinized. Okay, that's some of the gist. Okay, what about Mongling? Maybe you want to give other points than what Shuhaira has given. You can stand there if you like, but speak loud.
Actually, my point is almost same with her.
Okay.
And just some add-on I need to add.
Okay.
Is it the structure, the growth ring
okay.
that we observe, uh-huh. actually is constructed by the semi-crystalline in layer and the amorphous follow by that.
Okay.
Then it will in parallel way.
Mm-hmm. So the growth ring represents what? Represents the alternate layer, right? The alternate layer of the crystalline lamella. The crystalline lamella, which this crystalline lamella consists of the short chain amylopectin branches. So it alternates with the crystalline lamella and the amorphous lamella. The amorphous lamella consists of the alpha 1-6 branching point, the branch point before we get the clusters, the amylopectin branch clusters. We get, just imagine the ranting kayu, yeah? You get the ranting, but before the ranting branch out, you get the point where it start to branch out. That is the amorphous lamella. Then you have the bulk amorphous. The bulk amorphous consists of the amylose. Right? So that is important to understand the structure, how the amylose and the amylopectin being organized or packed together in the granule. Right? Okay, more? What about what happened when we use X-ray to characterize the different type of starch?
They were looked in a different shape.
They will show different X-ray pattern. Right? Different X-ray pattern. So how do we group the pattern? How many different patterns are there? A, B, and C. Yeah. So cereal starches fall under which group? Like corn, rice, and you know others. Fall under A. And tuber? B. And what about C? Yishan has disclosed that sago show C pattern. But she got that information from one paper from Fasihuddin, right? She's a... not you. But I share one paper. It's my own paper. So I don't know whether you have downloaded that paper. It's free. You can get the whole. That's a very comprehensive review actually on sago starch. So before I give you one lecture on sago, please read those papers. La Fasihuddin also very good paper, and my paper of course because it's cover everything on sago. Yeah, the composition, the ratio between amylose and amylopectin is very important because it affects the properties. But other than amylose and amylopectin, what other components in starch that can affect the functional properties?
Lipid
and protein. And how they affect the properties, you have to find out. And there are also other components, minor components such as phospholipid, phosphorus, yeah? Especially in potato starch. Potato starch is, the granule can swell very big. The swelling power is high compared to other starch. One of the reasons because of the presence of phosphorus. Yeah. So these are the minor components. Thank you. So I encourage you to use this technique, you know, try to explain to your friend what you have understood from the previous lecture. The technique that we use is now is called think, pair. So we do it in pair. And then share. Okay? So I want to try this more and more in my class so that you can use this as a reflection. Yeah? Remember, the best way to learn is to teach. The best way to learn is to teach. When we are teaching someone, we get a better understanding. When I teach about starch, of course, I did my PhD everything on starch, but the more I teach about, talk about starch, the more I understand about starch. So the best way to learn is to teach. And to teach is to learn twice. Because before you teach, you have to really understand, right? Otherwise, you cannot teach. So please take this message and try to practice more. Now, we have covered briefly in few lectures what starch is, how we extract starch from different sources, tuber, roots, cereal, what are the components and composition of starch, the characteristic of main component amylose and amylopectin. And we know there are also other minor components, although they are present in small amount, but they have significant effect on the properties, functional properties of starch. Okay. So now we want to learn more about the functional properties of starch and how we can exploit these properties in food product. And one of the important properties is gelatinization. When we cook the starch will undergo a process of gelatinization. This is when we get the functionalities of starch. In starch industry or in the industry, whenever we use starch, they have this term. They call it to functionalize the starch. So if you work with people from National Starch or from starch industry, they use this term, to functionalize the starch. It simply means that we want to get whatever properties that we want, the function of the starch. In this, in some cases, we use the starch to get as a thickener. We want the viscosity. In other situation, maybe we want to use the starch as a so-called like a gelling agent, yeah, to form a gel. In other situation, we want to use the starch for other properties. So in other words, we want to get the functions. So that's the meaning of to functionalize the starch, to get whatever properties that we want from starch. So now, the other one, apart from gelatinization, as a consequence of gelatinization, the next event is a retrogradation. So they always sort of together. Gelatinization always followed by retrogradation. In most cases, we do not want retrogradation because it can cause some undesirable effect. Like in bread, when the starch in the bread undergo retrogradation, the texture of the bread will become firmer, harder, and drier. So, you know, maybe from your experience after we store the bread for... But maybe nowadays it's difficult to see that because nowadays our bread is very... The technology is so advanced, but in the old days, when there are not so many types of bread at that time, yeah. So you will see after even 2 days, the bread will become harder, firmer, and more brittle, drier. So it's not that nice, yeah. But nowadays, maybe even after 1 week, the bread is still good, because we have added so many different types of additive to not to stop but to minimize or to slow down the process of retrogradation. Yeah, but that's the effect, the undesirable effect of retrogradation. The gel, the starch gel, if we form a gel, will become harder, firmer, and sometimes we get a phenomenon called cyanuresis. The water in the gel sort of squeeze out from the gel structure. Sometimes you can see also not in starch or in agar gel, you can get also separation of the water, which to the industry is not good. But in the gel, sometimes the water actually in the form of syrup separate from the gel, then it's quite nice. You can drink, you can sip the water, then you eat the gel. But in starch product, usually this is something that is not really desirable. So those are the negative effects of retrogradation. In most cases, we don't want. But in some cases, we do want retrogradation. Yeah? For example, nowadays, there is a product called resistant starch. Yeah? Resistant starch. In most cases, we want starch to be digested easily, especially in, you know, products for baby, infant food. We want the starch to be digested easily so that the baby, you know, don't have problem to digest the starch. So in this case, we use pre-gelatinized starch and so on, so that the starch can be digested easily. But in resistant starch, it's the opposite. We do not want the starch to be digested. And it's a very popular ingredient now in, you know, even Nestle also, if you notice, they promote some of their products. They said, contain resistant starch. I don't know whether you notice or not. Nestle also now using some of this resistant starch in some of their products. What is the use of resistant starch? Become like a fiber, hard to digest. Then? Not only because if you want to use resistant starch as a fiber, you can also use other type of fibers. Why resistant starch? Have you read anywhere? Because now you are in final year, I assume that you have read a lot of articles, you know, about food. So maybe you have come across about resistant starch, maybe. Have you heard the term, prebiotic? And probiotic. And do you know the difference? So resistant starch has been shown from research, has been shown to have a prebiotic property. Prebiotic means, you know, probiotic is the bacteria, the good bacteria, like bacillus, acidophilus, the bifidobacteria, lactobacillus in our yogurt, in Yakult, in Vitagen. They add this bacteria because they are good, friendly bacteria. So when we drink Yakult, this bacteria is supposed to colonize our colon, and they will produce like butyric acid and so on, which is good for our physiological, for our health, good for our gastrointestinal system. So, you know, when your stomach, your intestine, your colon, everything in good condition, it will generally, your health also will be good. If your stomach got problem, then the whole system also will have problem. So this is good, friendly bacteria. But this bacteria also is very sensitive to, you know, the heat. They can easily die. So in order to promote the growth, now this is a good bacteria that we want to help them to grow so that they can multiply. The more, we want more of them. You see, in Yakult, they claim they have how many billions? Billions, not million, of good bacteria. But by the time you drink Yakult, how much bacteria, viable bacteria is still there? Maybe, you know, thousands only. Yeah. So now the industry is trying to find ways to maintain the viability of this bacteria in the product as well as in the system. Because in the system, they have to fight with the enemies, the bad bacteria. We have so many bad bacteria also. So the theory says the more good bacteria we have in the system, the less the pathogenic bacteria and other bad bacteria will grow in our system. So they defeat the enemy and they will thrive, sort of. So this is when the prebiotic comes in. You can think of prebiotic like food for the good bacteria. So we have like inulin, we have FOS, fructooligosaccharide from inulin, we have a few things. And resistant starch has been found to promote the growth of this probiotic. So now, that's why we want to produce more resistant starch, because, of course, inulin and FOS, fructooligosaccharide, is a very good prebiotic. But then they are expensive. they are expensive. Maybe you have seen also Nestle add inulin in the milk. And so have you ever tried to find out why they add inulin? Why they add force? Because the theory is when the baby or whoever drink the milk, the inulin will promote the growth, support the growth of the good bacteria. Okay, but that actually caused the product containing inulin to have a higher price. So industry always look for cheaper option, cheaper alternative. In this case, resistant starch is a cheaper. To produce resistant starch, means it is resistant to the action of the enzyme in our stomach. So it won't be digested in our stomach. Then, if it's not digested, where it will go next? It will go finally to the colon. In the colon, it will get fermented by the good bacteria. And the process in the of that fermentation, the good bacteria will be happy. They will grow happily. And the byproduct of that is product like butyric acid, the short chain fatty acid. Butyric acid is short chain fatty acid, which have also a good effect on the food, good physiological effect on the body. But now the challenge is how to make starch resistant to the action of enzyme. We know that starch in a normal form will be easily digested by alpha amylase and amyloglucosidase, right? But now how we make it resistant? So this is now we can manipulate the process of retrogradation. And this time we want retrogradation. We want to retrograde the starch so that because retrograded starch is more resistant to enzyme action compared to normal non-retrograded starch. So this time you want to find the condition where the starch would retrograde. During retrogradation, actually the starch would crystallize. Even the amylose now, during retrogradation, would crystallize. And amylopectin, to some extent, would crystallize. But during retrogradation, after cooking, after gelatinization, during retrogradation, the amylose component would retrograde much faster than the amylopectin. And they are very resistant to enzyme action. So if I ask you, give one example when retrogradation is not desirable, and one example of when retrogradation is desirable. So I hope you can. But maybe you want to find more example when for these two situations, when the retrogradation is desirable and undesirable. Okay. But we are jumping the gun now, talking more about retrogradation. Let's talk about gelatinization. So we have native starch in water, and we call it starch suspension, or sometimes we use the term starch slurry. And we know that at room temperature, the starch is not soluble, insoluble. And it doesn't swell also, unless we leave for a long time, it can absorb some water. But when we heat up, the granules is in a powder form, it is the glass. At a glassy form, meaning that we have the glass transition temperature. Please recall the IMK 209. So to in a powder form is in a glassy state, but when we add water, the water act as a plasticizer, then it will depress the TG. And now the temperature of that because we are heating up, so the temperature would increase. The T now become above TG, so it will become rubbery. So now we the granule now would absorb more and more water, and it will start to swell. So I hope all of you have watched the video. Yeah, you can see the granule start to swell. That's the best illustration of the swelling of the granule during heating, and it will continue to granule to swell. So in this form, it's partially hydrated swollen granule, and now we increase the temperature above the TM. TM is melting temperature, but we know that for amorphous material there is no TM. We talk about TG only for amorphous, right? So why we talk about TM here? Melting. Which component in the starch granule actually melt? Does amorphous melt? No. What about crystalline? Yeah. When we say melting, we refer to a crystal. Only crystal melt. So which component in the starch granule melt? Amylopectin, because the amylopectin form the crystalline face or crystalline domain in the granule. So the TM here refers to the gelatinization, the melting of the amylopectin. So here the starch would start to gelatinize. So that is the onset, permulaan. That is the onset of gelatinization. Okay. So the term gelatinization actually refers to a collective event. Beberapa event yang berlaku. Absorption of water, swelling of the granule, yeah? Then increase in viscosity. So here, from this point right up to that, to this point, from this point up to this point, there is a progressive increase in the viscosity. So swelling, increase in viscosity, and also at the same time, although it's not shown here, some of the short chain amylose linear chain would diffuse out from the granule. In the video, you cannot see that, of course, because we cannot see molecules. We can only see the granules. Yeah, so some of the short chain amylose would come out. Amylopectin would remain inside the granule at up to this point, because they are big molecule and they have branches, so they are entangled with each other. So it's not easy for them to diffuse out. But the linear amylose molecule, especially the shorter chain, can sort of diffuse out from the granule. So this is a melted, hydrated, swollen granules. But during cooking, in most cases, we have also shear. We have stirring, we have maybe, most of the time we have, some form of shear. So because now the starch is subjected to shear, the swollen granule is very sensitive to shear, so it can now cause rupture, and when the granule ruptured, it will release the whatever content in the granule. So we have now the amylopectin and amylose now in the sol form, SOL, in the sol form. Solution, but technically when we say solution, it contains only small molecular weight that solubilized completely, but it's actually more like a colloidal solution, so we use the term sol. But now we have now amylopectin freely moving around, swimming around together with the amylose. So that is the whole event here is a process of gelatinization. This is the onset, and that is sort of called the completion part of gelatinization. we have a long standard definition from this. So it's a process involve the rupture and collapse of the order of in the molecule. Susun atu, the initially the amylopectin and amylose is being organized in an ordered form, structured in the granule, but now everything is disrupted, and it is this cause changes, irreversible changes. When it's ruptured, that's it. You cannot put it together and form a granule. So it's irreversible, and this is what happens during the gelatinization. The onset, titik permulaan, and the range of gelatinization temperature will depend on concentration of starch, how we observe that, whether we observe under the microscope, we look at the multiscross, or maybe we can use other methods like by maybe using DSC, probably the easiest way to see, to look at the DSC, or by using instrument like visco amylograph or rapid visco analyzer. So we monitor the viscosity. So there are many ways to determine. So when the gelatinization start, and what is the range of the temperature to complete the whole gelatinization process? It depends on the method that we use to measure or to observe the process. Sometimes they are slightly different, because when we look under the microscope, maybe it's quite subjective. But by using instrument like DSC or rapid visco analyzer, is probably more objective and easier to determine the onset and the final. Okay, go, Kok Min, eh? Can you answer that question? Or the answer is there, in the notes. No. Can starch undergo gelatinization without heating? Cannot. Can? But slow motion take time. Everything gelatinized if you wait long enough. Yeah. If you don't heat, then how do we gelatinize the starch? Use chemical. Use chemical. What type of chemical? Shen? No idea. By using enzyme? No. But you have to gelatinize the starch first. If you add enzyme to the ungelatinized starch in a dry form, well, there's some research have shown that some hydrolysis would occur also, because there's still some moisture there, but not gelatinization. But we can use chemical, yes. Azura said chemical, but what kind of chemical we can use? DMSO, yeah, you're quite right. But for food application, can we use DMSO? By the way, what is DMSO?
Dimethyl sulfoxide.
But for food application, can we use DMSO? DMSO is only used for analytical purposes, for food analysis. Yes, we can solubilize the starch by using the MSO. In fact, you can also break down the starch if you use too much of the MSO. Usually, we use the MSO to solubilize starch for analysis, for HPLC and so on. Yeah, so the MSO is actually a powerful solvent to solubilize starch, and in fact, technically, it will gelatinize starch, because it will make the starch granule to swell, yeah. And when the starch granule swell, it's kind of solubilized. But there's a common chemical we use to gelatinize starch, even without heating. NaOH. Sodium hydroxide, yeah, NaOH, or any alkaline solution, KOH also can, NaOH is common one. In yellow noodle, mie kuning, we use, well, if you ask those yang buat yellow noodle tu, dia kata dia tambah air abu. Air kapur. Air kapur tu apa? Air kapur is alkaline. Ya? Ya, kerana ada setengah orang panggil air abu. Ada setengah orang panggil air kapur. Ya? Yeah? Kapur is calcium hydroxide. Dulu orang tua yang orang Melayu kan, yang tua-tua makan sirih kan, dia taruh kapur. Kapur tu is slime. Calcium hydroxide. Pun alkaline juga. But the one that we use to make noodles, yellow noodles, Chinese call kansui. Kan? Those are alkaline. Kansui, betul saya sebut. Yeah? Those are alkaline solution. So, when in noodle making, in making noodle, they add this kansui or alkaline to serve a few purpose. One is actually to get the yellow, the natural yellow color. Yeah, the reaction with the pigment in the wheat flour will cause, will give the yellow color. But sometimes some noodle manufacturer they add more yellow because the natural yellow color may be not so strong, so they add yellow coloring. But anyway, we add when we add alkaline solution to starch, the starch would gelatinize. The starch would swell, even without heating. And in fact, if we use very highly concentrated pekat punya apa ni solution, alkaline solution, the starch would even degrade, depolymerize, very easy to break, so very strong. If we use acid, it won't gelatinize the starch, but it will just break down the starch, will fragment. So if you use acid, very strong acid, to some extent, yes, the starch would granule, but it will break down before it even start to swell, very strong. So this is actually used in the process of making dextrin. Later we will learn more about dextrinization, a process called dextrinization. Dextrinization is to produce dextrin. And in this case, we use highly concentrated acid. Yeah, but later when we learn about modified starch, we'll learn more about this. Yeah. Okay. So this is another definition for gelatinization. It's the destruction of molecular order, because in the granule we have a molecular order. The amylopectin form a semi-crystalline structure. So we destroy that crystalline structure. So when the starch gelatinizes completely, it will become totally, what is the opposite of crystalline? Amorphous. It will become totally amorphous. So that's the meaning of destruction of molecular order. So it become disordered. It become amorphous. Amorphous is disordered. And irreversible swelling. In native granule, if at room temperature, the granule will swell a bit, about 20%, 25-28%. But if we remove the water, we dry, the granule will shrink back. So it's reversible. But during gelatinization, if you increase the temperature and the granule swell, at some point, if you stop, remove the water, you dry, the swelling would not be reversible. So after it exceeds certain point, it becomes irreversible, meaning that the starch has undergone partial gelatinization at least. Yeah. So irreversible swelling of starch granule under the influence of heat or and or chemicals in aqueous medium to give a starch paste. When the starch gelatin, we start from starch slurry or starch suspension. So in the in this form, if we don't heat, we just let it stand on the table, for example, the starch would precipitate, separate into clear water and starch layer. But once we cook the starch completely, gelatinize the starch completely, it won't separate anymore. It will form either one of or two forms, of two forms. It will form paste or it will form gel. It will form paste or it will form gel. Which one? Which one? It will form paste or it will form gel. Which one? It depends on the concentration of starch. If we start maybe about 10% starch, then after the starch cook, we get paste. How do you know we get paste? We can pour. We can flow. If we start with 30% starch, but it depends on the type of starch also, but most starch. Rice starch maybe higher concentration. Sago, potato, if 30% starch we cook, it will form gel. How do you know? Try to pour, it won't flow. So it depends on the concentration of starch. So this term, gel and paste, so fast, huh? Okay, that's a warning, we have to stop lah. So the term paste and gel, we have to differentiate. Don't use it arbitrarily, because it refers to whether the starch can flow or the starch form gel cannot flow. Okay, so we stop here.